We're continuing in our series called Politicked, and it's been a fantastic series. How many have enjoyed the series that we're in? We really have. I really have. I think it's actually one of Pastor's best messages that he's preached. And every week that he preaches, I say the same thing. It's kind of like, oh, that one was better than that one, and that one was better than that one. But he's a fantastic speaker and preacher, and we're glad that he is our pastor. But this morning, I want to continue in this series, and I want to talk about the power of one. Now, if you're one person, raise your hand if you're a person. Ready? Raise your hand. I see some hands not going up over here. I don't know what you are, but everybody in here is a person, and you've got power on the inside of you, and you can do things to change the world. But I want to talk a little bit about how we got where we are as a nation, and we've come pretty far away from where we originally started. We originally started as a godly nation. We originally started with character and integrity, with morality, and we've come so far from where we first started. And so this morning, I want you to turn to Luke chapter 15, verse 11. Luke 15, verse 11. It says this, and you might know this story already, but it says, there was a man who had two sons. The younger said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there he squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to the fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. And I see that, and I read this. This is the story of the prodigal son, about how God had brought his son back to home and revitalized him and gave him life and gave him back everything that he had squandered away. But isn't this just kind of like America, that we have squandered away, not necessarily our finances, and that's not where I'm trying to go as far as being political, but we've squandered away our religious freedoms, if you will. We've squandered away our religious rights. We've squandered away our heritage when it comes to who we are and where we've come from. And we've said, you know what? I'm just going to do whatever I want to do. And you know what? Let the chips fall where they may. I'm going to decide to walk where I want to walk, to say what I want to say, to do what I want to do. But because of that, there is a great not reward, but there's a great penalty that we have paid throughout the years. When you look at our nation, we've really come so far, and not a good far. We've really gone in the wrong direction in the way that God wants us to be. And how did we get there? And I think that there's three main reasons why we've gotten where we are. Number one is this, is that we've believed a lie. We've completely believed a lie. It says in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 18, pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. And I think that's where we have come from, as a nation, that we've gotten prideful and arrogant in who we are. Well, we're the best. We've heard for so long that we're the best, that we're the best, that we're the best. We're the most religious nation. We're the best Christian nation. And we think that, and we've taken it for granted that we can go to church and get right with God at any time, because there are churches all over our nation. You can drive down the street in 5 minutes. You can find 20 different churches. But yet, church attendance is low. Why is that? It's because we've squandered away our Christian heritage, and we've believed a lie. Number two is that we've engaged in self-destructive behavior, just like this young man did. He engaged in self-destructive behavior where he thought that he could do whatever he wanted and everything would be okay. But there comes a day when you've got to pay the price. He had absolutely everything if he would have just stayed in his father's house. But yet he demanded what was his, and he went out and he spent it. It got so bad that he pretty much prostituted himself so that he could have a job. He went in and said, so that he could have food. He went in, he fed pigs, and he was so hungry that he wanted to eat the food out of a pig trough. Now, I don't know about you. I've never desired or longed to eat food out of a pig trough. Maybe they had some good-looking apples that day that were ripe for the picking. Maybe they had some good leftovers. I don't know, but it got so bad that he wanted to stick his face where the pigs eat. And what has happened? He believed a lie and he engaged in self-destructive behavior. He isolated himself from those that can help. He completely left his father, left his family, and said, I'm not only going to leave you, not only am I going to leave you, but I'm going to take everything that is rightfully mine, Dad, and I'm going to go out and do what I want with my money. Not only am I going to go to the next town, but I'm going to go to a whole nother country, and I'm going to show you how great I am. And he started to divulge and isolate himself into away from those that can help. He stepped away from his father's house. Isn't that just like America? That we've stepped away from God's own house. We've stepped away from the one who can very help us in times of need. And we look towards the government, we look towards people, we look towards all these programs to help us, but yet we still isolate ourselves. Instead of going to the one that can solve our problems, we go to the people that cause the problems. And we find ourselves in a dark place. The psalmist said in chapter 88, verse 8, he said, you made my friends to loathe me, and they have gone away, and I'm in a trap with no way out. Have you ever felt like there's no way out? Have you ever felt like you're just in this place and you're just kind of spinning your wheels? Have you ever looked at the two candidates and said, God, bless America. God, would you please help us? My son came to me with a joke a few weeks ago, and he said, Dad, Hillary and Trump, they're in a burning building, and there's no way out. Who wins? Or who survives? I said, I don't know. He said, America survives. Thank you for laughing. I appreciate that very, very much. Have you ever felt like we're just stuck? We're stuck with the choices that these two parties have given us. Have you ever felt that way? I feel that way. But here's the deal. And I'm going to talk to the church. Everybody raise your hand if you're in church this morning. Every hand should be going up. Here's the deal. I'm not talking to America. I'm talking to the church this morning. Okay? I want to give you a few statistics. In the last presidential election, only 53% of Americans voted. Almost half didn't vote. There are over 240 million voting aged Americans, yet nearly 100 million consistently choose not to vote. Church, the reason why we're here is because of us, because the church hasn't rightfully stepped in and said enough is enough. Only 50% of Christians in America are registered to vote. Of those, only 50% show up at the polls, meaning 75% of all Christians are not taking advantage of their one of their greatest privileges. I don't know about you, but my grandfather fought for our country. I've had family members that have died for our country and for the right for us to vote. We have a great honor and a privilege to vote here in America. Well, Pastor, I'm fed up. I'm so fed up with the process. I am too. But that's not going to keep me silent. That's not going to stop me from going out and me voicing my opinion by who I pull the lever for. Well, you don't really pull the lever for anymore, but who you press the button for. I'm not going to be silenced by what people think. Did you know that if every Christian would register to vote and then so do so, candidates who share their beliefs and values would win the presidency by a landslide? We have a voice, but I think we're so afraid to share our voice. We're so afraid to talk about the things that matter to us. We're afraid. Check this out, Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 20, or verse 30, it says, I looked for a man among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in a gap on behalf of the land so I would not have to destroy it, but I found none. Now, don't think that I use this scripture for Donald Trump because he wants to build a great wall. It has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. This wall has nothing to do with that wall, okay? But this is what scripture says. It says that I looked for a man and he couldn't find anybody. He wasn't looking for a people group. He wasn't looking for a party. He wasn't looking for a comb over. He wasn't looking for any of those things. He was looking for a man that would stand up and stand in the gap, but he couldn't find anybody. And the reason why he couldn't find anybody is because we're afraid. I want to give you a few things why we are where we are is because we're afraid. Number one, we're afraid of our past. We're afraid of our personal past. We're afraid of our mistakes. We're afraid of our misdealings and our misleadings. We're afraid of our sins. We're afraid of all the things that we've done wrong. We're afraid of the things that we've said that might be not politically correct. We've hurt people, and we're afraid of people finding out about our past. We're afraid that God is gonna take back the things that he put in our heart. He's gonna take back those passions and those desires. He's gonna take back those gifts and those abilities because of our past. And so therefore, I can't stand up for what God tells me to stand up for. But check this out, Romans 11, verse 29. God's gifts and God's call are under full warranty, never canceled and never rescinded. You know what that means? Is that God is not expecting you to take out a 2-year extension warranty on your calling and your gifting. God's gifts do not expire in 30 days or 60 days or 90 days like the things that you buy at the store. God says that my gifts go on for eternity. They're never canceled. They're under full warranty. Guess what? Even though that you might have messed up, and even though you might have failed, and even though you might have said something wrong, and even though you might have done something wrong, doesn't mean that you still can't stand up for righteousness. As a matter of fact, it gives me a greater hope to know that when I have messed up, is that God is standing up with me, and I can stand up because he's the one that is holding me up. Number two is we're afraid of the crowd. The crowd is either for us or against us. They either love us or they hate us, but they will be angry at me. The crowd, they will ridicule me. The crowd, they will make fun of me. Or if they love you, maybe you will say, the crowd, they love me. They think I'm funny. They think I'm smart. But what we've done is we've put the wrong emphasis on the wrong two people. We've put the emphasis on the crowd and us. And that's exactly opposite of where God wants the emphasis at. You see, it's not about you and it's not about me. It's not about the Democrats or the Republicans or the Independents. It's not about that. It's not about Hillary or Trump. It's not about liberalism. It's not about conservatism. It's not about those things. It's about God. And I think it's time that we stand up. You see, we put the wrong emphasis on the wrong thing and we're concerned about the crowd. Proverbs 29 verse 25 says this, "Fear of man will prove to be a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord is kept safe." You see, when we fear man, we're held back by what we want to do. We're held back by what God is calling us to do. The fear of human opinion disables us. Trusting in God protects us from that. Number three is that we're afraid to take the first step. We're afraid to take the very first step. And what I mean by taking the first step is that you've got to step out in faith. And faith is more than weighing the consequences. Faith is more than just weighing out the pros and the cons, the goods and the bads. Hebrews chapter 11. And this is where I'm going to get a little bit long here. I want everybody to just kind of bear with me a little bit. Is it okay if I actually read like a whole chapter of the Bible? Is that all right? Good, I'm glad. Because if it's not, I'm going to do it anyways. Hebrews chapter 11, and if you don't know, Hebrews chapter 11 is kind of like the faith chapter. It's kind of where we get pumped up as Christians. It's kind of like, man, if everything's going wrong in my life, go to this chapter right here because it will pump you up. I mean, read it like 10 times before you got to go into an interview. Read it 10 times before you got to go do something, before you come home and you're bummed that your wife didn't make you dinner, before you come home and you see the big pile of laundry that your husband never folded. You know, I don't fold the clothes in my house. Anybody, men, do you fold the clothes? I do the dishes, but I don't fold the clothes. Me and my wife have kind of made like a deal. As long as I do the dishes, she will fold the clothes, right? Amen. It works good for our house. So here's faith. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now faith is, stop. When is faith? Faith is now. Faith is not tomorrow. It's not next week. It's not when you've got it all figured out. It's not when somebody calls you and said it's okay to do it. It's not when somebody likes you on Facebook. It's not when you get Instagram, you know, all these kind of things. It's not when somebody gives you a high five or a handshake. That's not when faith is. Faith is now. So now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, the elders obtain a good testimony. Verse 3, by faith, we understand that the worlds were framed and by the word of God. Verse 4, by faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. Verse 5, by faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death. Verse 6, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Verse 7, by faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen. Verse 8, by faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out into the place where he would receive as an inheritance. Verse 9, by faith, he dwelt in the land of the promise as in a foreign country. Verse 11, we're going to keep going. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive a seed. Now, I don't know about you, that's pretty amazing faith right there. And I'm not going to say old, but I'm going to say seasoned, okay? Sarah was a seasoned woman. And she was old enough not just to have grandkids, but to have great grandkids. I mean, she was a very seasoned woman. And God says, you're about to have a child. And she laughed. But her faith brought her through. And because of her faith, she had a seed and she had a child. By faith, verse 17, check this out. Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. Verse 20, by faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things to come. Verse 21, by faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph. Do you kind of see a pattern here? It's not about what the crowd says. It's not about how I feel, but it's by faith. Verse 22, by faith, Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the departure of the children of Israel and gave instruction concerning his bones. Verse 23, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because he saw he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's command. Now, I don't know if you catch that. I don't know if you know what the command was. The command was from the king by the country to kill all the children under a certain age. Why? Because there was a prophecy that another kid, another king, if you will, another man is going to lead the Israelites into freedom, that he is going to bring something about, and the king didn't want that. So he made a decree to kill all the little kids under a certain age. Wow. Do you get that? Check this out. This is a wow moment. That he decided, that they decided that they weren't going to take what the government was trying to shove down their throats as gospel. That they stepped up in faith. Verse 24, by faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God that enjoy the passing pleasure of sin. That's another wow moment. I don't know if you're quite getting it the way that I'm getting it. But what happens here is that Moses decides to separate himself from his political party, if you will. Moses is raised to be a king. In Egypt, Moses is raised to have it all. Moses is raised to be a general, a great commander. Moses is raised to have an inheritance that is above everybody else's. But he refuses to take that. As a matter of fact, he separates from his political party. He separates from his family, if you will. He separates from his closest friends, not because of the color of their skin. He doesn't join the Jews and the Israelites because of the same skin color. But he separates himself from Egypt because of his faith. By faith, Moses did these things. Check it out, verse 28. By faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of the blood. Verse 29, By faith, they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land. Verse 31, by faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe. Now check this out. This is where it really gets kind of fun for me. I like this part of the scripture, verse 32. And I'm just going to go word for word here for just a moment. Verse 32, and what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became valiant in battle, turned to fight the armies of the aliens, and women received their dead as raised to life. You see, the pattern here is not to follow the crowd, but it's to follow God in faith. Verse 39, all these having obtained a good testimony through faith did not receive the promise. Verse 40, God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. We're going to go into chapter 12, and here's the deal. When you read the Bible, you can't just stop at a chapter. That's not the way that the author wrote it. He didn't just stop. He just kind of kept going. The chapters and the verses are what we created centuries later to make it easier to read. But he doesn't stop his thought at that moment. He says in chapter 12, verse 1, therefore, and I'm just going to stop here in just a moment. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, who are the witnesses? The witnesses are these people of faith that are looking over sapphire sills of heaven, and they're watching us. And what are they watching us to do? Check this out. It says that so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endures such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged of your souls or in your souls. What's the Apostle Paul saying here? He's saying, listen, all these people that I just mentioned are looking over and they're watching you run your race. They're watching you about to do amazing things for God. You see, when we read this chapter, we read it and it pumps us up about the things that they did. But what we should do is when we read this chapter is we should get so pumped up because they're watching us about to do the things that God has called this generation to do, to stand up and to live by faith. Chapter 11 demonstrates how faith should be. It's the only kind of acceptable faith to God. It's a faith that is triumphant in the worst situations. A faith that believes in spiritual realities. A faith that leads to righteousness. A faith that seeks God. A faith that believes goodness. A faith that has confidence in his very word. A faith that obeys his commands. A faith that regulates his promises. A faith that rejects the spirit of this evil age. A faith that seeks a heavenly home. A faith that preserves in its testing. A faith that blesses the next generation, Pastor Brandon. A faith that refuses sin's pleasures. A faith that endures persecution. A faith that performs mighty acts of righteousness. A faith that suffers for God. And a faith that does not return to the world that it left behind. You see, we have got to be people of faith instead of people of the crowd. But maybe you've done all these things. Maybe you've forgotten about your past and you said, you know what, I'm going to move on. Maybe you've silenced the crowd in your mind and you're stepping out in faith. And if you're anything like me, that as soon as you start to take that step of faith and you start to believe in God, the enemy comes in and he tries to attack you in your brain and he tells you that you're going to fail. Has it ever happened to anybody? It happens to me. When you step out in faith, the enemy just comes in. You're going to fail. Says you're not going to make it. You're not going to be any good. What if I say something wrong? And that's number four, by the way, is that we're afraid of failure. What if I say something wrong? What if I look stupid? This one's a big one for me. I don't want to look stupid. Why? Because I represent not just my church, not just my family, but I represent the King of Kings in every situation, in every day of my life. You see, when you put it in that perspective, it changes things. I represent the King of Kings. I don't represent a party. I don't represent a person, but I represent the one who hung on the cross and died for me. What if I mess up so bad that God doesn't even like me? What if I mess up and I'm all by myself? You see, again, we're putting the wrong emphasis on the wrong people. We're putting it on ourselves and other people. And God says, put the emphasis on me. I love what Genesis chapter 9 says in verse 13. I was driving home from the city the other day, and it was completely pouring the whole day, and it got to a place where it was raining on one side and cloudy, and then the sun was trying to break through just a little bit. And you know what I saw? Saw me a rainbow. And you know what the rainbow represents? That God ain't going to kill us with a flood again. It says in Genesis chapter 9, 13, it says, I have placed my rainbow in the clouds. No clowns. Hey, listen, no clowns Friday night. I'm just saying that, all right? No clowns at the Fall Fest. We don't do clowns up in here. I don't like clowns. I've shared my story about clowns. Clowns are demonic, I'm telling you right now. My grandma, Grandpa, I know you're watching. My grandma, she used to have a... This is totally off the cuff, and I shouldn't go there because it's just going to make the message longer, but you're going to enjoy it, right? So anyways, I go to my grandma's house, and she had this porcelain clown doll that would sit on the shelf right next to the bed, and it freaked me out. I had to take that clown doll and put it in the other room. I hate that doll. Like, I hope that doll never makes it to my house, because Grandpa and Grandma, I love you, but ain't coming. I don't want that thing. So anyways... So God says that he placed the rainbow in the clouds as a sign of a promise until the end time to you and all the earth. What's he saying? He's saying, I don't work in one generation. I work in all generations. Matthew chapter 28, verse 20. And to be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. But I really love how the psalmist said it in Psalm chapter 139. He says in 7 and 8, verse 7 and 8, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. God is everywhere. God is in London right now trying to help the Giants defeat the Rams. It was 10-10 when I got up to preach in the middle of the third quarter. I don't know what the score is now. Don't tell me. Don't say anything. Don't shout nothing out, right? Oh, the Cowboys are 5-1. The season ain't over. So I want to give you a couple attributes of who God is. Is that okay? Number one is that God is perfect and holy. Kind of describes about who God is. God is always there for us. He's perfect and holy, which means he's completely without sin and absolutely righteous. God is unchangeable. It means that there is no chance in his attributes that in his perfections or in his purpose. Excuse me. There is no change in his attributes, in his perfections or in his purpose towards humankind. God is eternal. He is from everlasting to everlasting. God is transcendent, which means he is different and independent from his creation, but able to live among them as their God. God is omnipotent. He is all powerful and has ultimate authority over all things. God is omnipresent. He is present everywhere at the same time. God is omniscient, which means that he knows everything. He knows not only your action, but your very thoughts. When the Bible speaks of his foreknowledge, it means that he knows that all things that are possible as possible, that all things as certain, all things contingent as contingent, and all things as future, all things past as the past, all things foreordained as predestined certainties. You know what that means? It pretty much means this. This is the best quote that I could possibly give you. The best definition of who God is and what he can do. When I was in Bible college, I was talking to this young man, and it was a bunch of us talking to each other, and he was kind of new in his faith and kind of raw. He'd just gotten saved and decided to go to college, and he thought that God wanted, and he's doing something great for God today. But he didn't have the lingo down, you know, like pastor lingo, like you don't cuss, like that's pastor, you know, so that's like what pastors, they're not supposed to do, right? You don't cuss. And so here's the deal. This guy, he gets up, we're talking about how God can do whatever he wants, all those kind of things. And this is what he said. God can do whatever he blankety blank wants to whenever he blankety blank wants to. And honestly, that's like the best definition that you can possibly have, right? To whom, whoever he blankety blank wants to do it to. And in all seriousness, That's how God operates. God is not stopped by his own foreknowledge. And what I'm trying to set up right now is this, is that we know that God knows everything. We know that God is all these different things. And I want you to turn to Numbers right now. Turn to Numbers chapter 14. And I want to set up this chapter for you for a second. This is after the Israelites have left Egypt. They've had the mass exodus. They've left. They've crossed over the river. The walls of the river had gone up. God has shown miraculous sign after miraculous sign after miraculous sign after miraculous sign. He's done absolutely amazing things. And all of a sudden, the Jews, they started to murmur and complain. Kind of sounds like the church world, right? They get mad and upset. The church world gets mad and upset. They get mad and upset at God. No, I would never get mad and upset with God. I would never do that. But yet, we question God when we pray and we don't have an answer. God, I prayed that I would be healed of cancer and I'm not healed yet. God, I prayed for a financial miracle. God, I prayed that my husband would return. God, I prayed that my wife would be delivered, that my kids would be saved. And you've done nothing, God. But yet, all the while, God has done and performed miracle after miracle after miracle in your life. And yet, we murmur and complain just like the Israelites had done. And the Israelites murmured and complained to the point God said, I'm going to kill every one of them. No, he said that. You might be thinking, I can't believe God would say something like that. Why would God be so nasty? How many parents we have in the room? Regina, if you're a parent. So you're on vacation and your kids have asked you a billion times, are we there yet? Are we there yet? How much longer are we there? I'm bored. Johnny's poking me. Bobby's doing, Sarah said this. She just flicked a booger on me. And all you're thinking is, if they say one more thing, I'm going to drive this car off a cliff and I'm going to show them. We do the same thing and God is frustrated. But Pastor, you just said that God sees everything and God knows everything and God understands where his people are. Not understands, but he knows what's about to happen. But yet God is not bound by what he knows, because he can change the plan as long as the plan stays the same and the outcome is still the same. So here's the deal. I'm going to set this up for you. Ready? Here we go. Numbers chapter 14, 10 through 20. It says, but the whole assembly talked about stoning them. And there's three guys. There's Joshua, there's Aaron, and there's Moses. And they're trying to tell the Israelites, hey, listen, we're going to go with this plan. We're going with this. And the crowd wants to kill them. They want to go back to slavery. They want to go back. Well, we had it so much better when we were slaves in Egypt. And we had to work so hard and we were whipped and we were chained and beaten to death because of our faith. We had it so much better, right? Sounds like America, right? So anyways, but the whole assembly talked about stoning them. Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent meeting to all the Israelites. The Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe in me? In spite of all the signs I've performed among them, I will strike them down with a plague and destroy them. But I will make you into a nation greater and stronger than they. Man, Moses is like, he's legit. God's telling, he's saying, Moses, I'm going to kill them all, but I'm going to make you awesome. But Moses' reply is awesome. Check this out. Moses said to the Lord, then the Egyptians will hear about it. By your power, you brought these people up from among them, and they will tell their inhabitants of this land about it. They have already heard that you, Lord, are with these people, and that you, Lord, have been seen face to face, that your cloud stays over them, and that you go before them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. If you put all these people to death, leaving none alive, the nations who have heard this report about you will say, the Lord was not able to bring these people into the land as he promised them in an oath. So he slaughtered them in the wilderness. Verse 17. Now may the Lord's strength be displayed, just as you have declared. The Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love and forgiving in sin and rebellion. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children for the sins of the parents to the third and fourth generation. In accordance with your great love, forgive the sin of these people, just as you have pardoned them from the time they left Egypt until now. So Moses, he stands before God after God told him, I'm going to kill every one of them and I'm going to make you great. Moses stands before God and he says, God, you can't do that because you say that you are forgiving. And you say, and he reminds God of God's promises. He reminds God that his promises are yes and amen. In a sense, it's essential that Moses stands in the gap right here. One man stands before God and reminds God of the promises that God himself made. And you know what God's response was? Verse 20, the Lord replied, I have forgiven them just as you asked. You see, God foresaw the nation of Israel doing these things, but he knew that there was a man that would stand in the gap. He knew that there was going to be a man of God who would stand up for righteousness. He knew that there was a man of God who was gonna stand up for character and integrity. And you know what God did? Is that God forgave them. You might be thinking, well, Pastor, I'm not Moses. No, you're not. Moses is looking down at you right now, wondering, when are you gonna start to run your race? You see, there's power in one. You may think that you're insignificant, but you're not. You've got more power on the inside of you than you ever thought possible. You know what the name of that is? It's called Jesus, the Christ, the anointed one, and his anointing. He can save this nation and deliver this nation once again. You see, we're not voting for a party. We're not voting for a person or a comb over. We're not even voting for a government or a democracy. You know what we're fighting for? We're fighting for values. We're fighting for life. We're fighting for righteousness. We're fighting for godliness. And some of us in this room, we're tired. We're tired of all the things that the people have said, and it's time for us to start to fight again. It's time for us to stand up again. It's time for us to get up off our butts and to do something for God. Well, Pastor, what is it that we're fighting for? It's time for us to stand up and fight for those closest to you. To stand up and fight for your family, to stand up and fight for your friends, to stand up and fight for your loved ones. Why is that so important? Because God is always, throughout the generations, he's always looking for one person. He's looking for the one. He's not looking for the crowds. He's looking for the one to stand up, to stand up. Genesis chapter 7, verse 1 says, the Lord then said to Noah, go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I found you righteous in this generation. God didn't say to Noah's friends, he said to Noah. As a matter of fact, there was nobody righteous. Everybody was wrong. The crowds were wrong. Noah, God gives Noah the commands to build this great ark, to build this big, huge boat to save people and to save humanity and to save all the animals. And Noah goes out to wherever he goes out to, hanging out with his buddies, watching some soccer and some football and whatever he's doing, he's hanging out with his buds. And he tells them, hey guys, he's gonna bring this thing called rain. I know you've never seen it before because it never rained back in those days. The water came up from the ground. And he said, God's gonna bring clouds and water's gonna fall out of the clouds. It's gonna be called rain. And God's gonna flood the whole earth. But why don't you guys come on the boat and save yourselves? And they all looked at Noah like, dude, you're crazy. You just made up this word called rain. Right? Isn't it funny how leaders make up words? Right? He makes up this word called rain. You guys didn't get that joke, but it's okay. And so Noah, he makes up this word called rain. He says it's gonna rain down, and nobody believes him. The crowds don't believe him, but yet he still does what God calls him to do because he's not afraid of the crowd. You see, it doesn't take a village to save a child, it takes one person. Acts chapter 16, verse 31 says, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. You see, it's time that we stand up and we fight for our people, that we stand up for our family. Number two, it's time that we stand up and fight for our generation. There's never been another generation that is so far from God that we have no identity of who we are anymore. That we think that we're a female if we're a male and a male if we're a female. Listen, just look what God gave you and you can figure it out. It's time that we start to fight for this generation. Jeremiah 15, 19 says, you are to influence them. Do not let them influence you. You see, remember, God is the God of the universe. He is the God that is standing on your behalf. He wants you to be the person of influence. He's calling you. We also need to stand up and we need to fight for God. 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. You know what God says? He says, when you stand up for me, I'm going to fight for you. When we're loyal to God and not loyal to a party, when we're not loyal to a person, when we're not loyal to a particular thing, but we're loyal to him, God says, I'm gonna fight for you. And lastly, is that we need to stand up and we need to fight for our nation. We need to fight for our nation. Maybe you're just like me and you're ticked off with politics. You're ticked off with Obama and Hillary and Trump. You're ticked off with the whole situation. And you're in line with the majority of America and the world. But we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We wrestle against spiritual things in high places that are trying to tear us down. Can I tell you something? Hillary is not your enemy. Trump is not your enemy. And we say we're fighting for our country, but yet we have so much hate when we put it on Facebook. Oh, this person said this. How can this person be a Christian? I don't care if they're a Christian if you really want to know the truth, because I know the God who can do things and move mountains if we stand up for it. First service was much better on that. Just so you know, you got beat up on that one. You see, we post all these things on Facebook. We post and we say all these things, but yet we refuse to do exactly what God has asked us to do. Not to make fun, not to hurt people, not to slander people. You know what God has asked us to do? 2 Chronicles 7:14. This is my last scripture. It says this: if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, and I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Can I tell you, amen. Can I tell you what it doesn't say? It doesn't say, if my white people who are called by my name. It doesn't say, if my black people who are called by my name. It doesn't say, if my Hispanics who are called by my name, if my Asians who are called by my name. It doesn't say, if my Democrats or my Republicans or my Independents who are called by my name. Not if my Libertarians or Conservatives or Liberals who are called by my name. It doesn't even specify a country. It doesn't say that if Americans would humble themselves and pray and call by my name. It doesn't say that. But what it does say is it says that those who lay down their past and lay down their race and those who are willing to give up their earthly inheritance and their rights to be noticed, but push on towards the call of Jesus Christ. Those who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land. If my people who would stand up for righteousness, who would stand up for godliness, who would stand up for character and morality, if they would do that, I would be their people and I would heal them. I'm gonna close with this last story. I know it's a little bit long and I apologize. This last story is found in scripture and you can read it. It's Hezekiah. Hezekiah is the king. He's on his deathbed and the prophet comes before him. And God tells the prophet, go to Hezekiah and tell him he's about to die. And he's on his deathbed. And the prophet tells him, and Hezekiah stops. He says, that ain't gonna happen, because I'm going to pray and I'm going to remind God of what he told me. And one man who stood up, prayed, reminded. Again, we've heard this story multiple times. Noah, Moses, Hezekiah. Multiple times that God has tried to find people on earth and he found nobody to stand in the gap. But Hezekiah, the king, he stands up in the gap and he prays and he reminds God. And as the prophet is leaving, God speaks to the prophet and he says, go back and tell Hezekiah, not only is he going to live, but I'm going to give him 15 more years. Not only is he going to have 15 more years, but I'm going to heal his land. I'm going to be the God of their nation. I'm going to protect this city. You see, one person can make a difference. And if one person can make a difference, imagine what a group of people can do. If my people who are called by my name would stand up for righteousness, would turn back towards me again, then I would heal their nation. Would you stand to your feet as we close in prayer?